Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Unguessed Kinships, Naturalism and the Geography of Hope in Cormac McCarthy, by Stephen Frye. Narrated by Danny Campbell. Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Matthew, chapter 10, verse 16. Chapter 1. Naturalism and Polyvalence in Cormac McCarthy. Beauty is mysterious as well as terrible. God and the devil are fighting there, and the battlefield is the heart of man. Fyodor Dostoevsky, The Brothers Karamazov. Cormac McCarthy grew up in Knoxville, Tennessee. In the 1930s, this city in the southern Appalachian Mountains was emblematic of America's transition to modernity. Many in the region lived without hydroelectric power, and even people in more populated areas waited for the iceman and the dairyman, relying on an economy of limited and local exchange. The land was never far from their lives. It was a source of sustenance and beauty, and formed an intricate tapestry of collective memory. Changes to what had once been an implacable wilderness had a tangible effect on communities and individuals, not just in terms of the practicalities involved in daily living, but in the realm of worldview and perception. What did it mean to relate to the land in more indirect ways? How does one cope with the mediation of machines in what were once small towns, communities now being transformed into new urban spaces constituted on no known paradigm? Knoxville in the 1930s and 1940s works as a metaphor for the larger socioeconomic realities of American history. The forces of industrial progress have always confronted a wilderness peopled not only with indigenous populations, but with a vanguard of settlers who shaped and were shaped by a dense, violent, and seemingly impenetrable frontier. The existence of the wilderness is only one defining influence on the development of American culture. But the human consequences of these historical pressures became the substance of a significant strand of a new and evolving literary tradition. Cormac McCarthy is a modern culmination of that tradition. His work reveals the changing textures of the American landscape, and by his own admission, he embraces an aesthetic of influence. But through the mysterious alchemy of his own imagination, he transforms the canon and makes it new. T.S. Eliot would call McCarthy a writer with historical sense, since he reenacts such works as the King James Bible, Dante's Divine Comedy, the tragedies of Shakespeare, and the novels of Melville, Dostoevsky, Faulkner, and Hemingway. McCarthy's reading life is active and his consumption of the Western canon prodigious, though in his later years he has focused primarily on philosophy and science. But his connection to all these works is more than passive, and he does not read them at a critical remove. Like many of our greatest innovators, he approaches literature with a creative mind and perceptive capacity, not as an admirer, but with the active motivation of one who intends to break apart and rebuild, to absorb and re-envision. He has said that books are made out of books, and the act of making has a particular resonance when we consider McCarthy's artistic practice. As far as we know, even in the age of Microsoft Word and Apple Pages, he still uses an Olivetti typewriter. This is not a reactionary gesture or the posture of someone lamenting a bygone time. Even the most casual look at McCarthy's archived drafts reveals a complex creative process involving reading, research, and contemplation, as well as philosophical, scientific, and artistic engagement. All this is enhanced by a layered and tenacious commitment to the rigors of revision. It is a process developed over 60 years of writing, one that early on became dependent on the only technology available to him. No transformation in machinery could alter an approach that allowed McCarthy to absorb the tradition and make it his own. Like Ben Telfair in The Stonemason, 1994, McCarthy builds his works using old stones, taking on faith that those materials will hold together and stand against the vicissitudes of history. Western literature resonates through time, and it is worthwhile to look closely at the stones themselves and trace the architecture that binds them in McCarthy's collective canon. Works emerging from classical Greece and Rome, the ancient Near East, and the European Renaissance, as well as later texts from the 19th and 20th centuries, are all a part of the pattern. But to consider McCarthy's use of the literature alone is to establish barriers that limit an understanding of influence in his work. McCarthy's residence at the Santa Fe Institute is a testimony to his fascination with science and its expansive reach into the realm of philosophy. He was asked to revise the operating principles of the Institute, and he wrote the following. Scientific work at SFI is always pushing creativity to its practical limits. We always court a high risk of failure. Above all, we have more fun than should be legal. We are absolutely relentless at hammering down boundaries created by academic disciplines and institutional structures. If you know more than anybody else about a subject, we want to talk to you. We don't care what the subject is. We are beyond relentless in seeking out the best people in every discipline. We will get you here, no matter what, and we will give you the space and the resources that you need. We don't care how young you are. We have in general avoided becoming involved in matters of policy. But if you are working on a program that involves sustainability or the environment or human welfare, and you think we might have something you can use, pick up the phone. The educational opportunities that we offer, especially for young people, are simply not available elsewhere. Period. Occasionally, we find that an invited guest is insane. This generally cheers us all up. We know we're on the right track. McCarthy challenges the partitioning that occurs as methodologies evolve in an academic setting. He writes about eradicating boundaries, echoing his own fascination with malleable borders, more than physical, but intellectual and imaginative. McCarthy rejects the popular dichotomy between heart and mind, a tension heightened by the dual legacies of the Enlightenment and Romanticism. McCarthy's operating principles suggest that rationality, intuition, empirical inquiry, and imagination merge in a strange chemistry, one that takes the human community to new territories and into realms beyond the practical and utilitarian. The Santa Fe Institute was founded on the notion of cross-disciplinary inquiry centering on the exploration of complex adaptive systems. It was established in 1984 by scientists George Cowan and Murray Gell-Mann, among others, and has become the most renowned institute dedicated to contemporary issues related to complexity theory. In the summer of 2019, David Krakauer, president of the Santa Fe Institute, delivered the keynote address to the semi-annual conference of the Cormac McCarthy Society. His talk dealt in detail with the current state of understanding in complexity science, the specific role of the Santa Fe Institute in these inquiries, and McCarthy himself as a trustee and regular interlocutor in the Institute's discussions. Krakauer emphasized both the freedom offered to fellows in his community and the scientific rigor demanded of them. His keynote led to vigorous discussion involving Krakauer himself, filmmaker Carol Yarahovsky, and the literary scholars attending the conference. During the Q&A, Krakauer emphasized something that speaks powerfully to McCarthy's work and his role at a scientific institute, aesthetics. Any understanding the human community comes to achieve in complexity science will ultimately emerge from a creative capacity similar to what has led to the greatest works of art. One might infer from Krakauer's comments that the intuition of the scientist is not precisely the same as that of the artist. Coming from different patterns of thought, they share a disparate range of experiences, and the totality of those experiences lead to conclusions emerging from distinct vantage points. But still, each employs the raw material of deep, earnest thinking as they seek insight into realms hitherto unknown, as they venture into Melville's ocean perishing, his vast, open, and unremembering sea. There is more shared by the scientist and the artist than is conventionally assumed, since both seek truth and beauty in tandem and in essential relation. Near the end of the discussion, Krakauer seemed to echo the poet John Keats, who in the last lines of Ode on a Grecian Urn, 1819, wrote, "When old age shall this generation waste, thou shalt remain, in midst of other woe than ours, a friend to man, to whom thou sayest, beauty is truth, truth beauty. That is all ye know on earth, and all ye need to know." Academic and intellectual taxonomies have practical value in any pursuit of knowledge, but taken on face value, they often lead to divisions that breed erroneous popular conceptions and a peculiar kind of false consciousness. The distinct philosophical categories of epistemology and aesthetics, treated independently, cloud and even obscure their essential relation. This is not to say that the artist will discover and codify the principles that govern the nature of physical reality. That, of course, is the role of the scientist. But the artist may in some way intuit those principles in works that can only be appreciated through the whole of the human mind. Truth will be understood not only in empirical terms, but through the complementary capacities of artist, philosopher, and scientist. In 2019, Krakauer compiled a collection of essays that represent the Santa Fe Institute's inquiries into complexity science since 1984. The volume is entitled Worlds Hidden in Plain Sight, The Evolving Idea of Complexity at the Santa Fe Institute, 1984 to 2019. As an epigram to the introduction, Krakauer quotes Edgar Allan Poe from The Purloined Letter. They consider only their own ideas of ingenuity, and in searching for anything hidden, advert only to the modes in which they would have hidden it. In this founding work of detective fiction, Poe strives to map the human intellect at its finest and most transformative. The detective blends the capacities of poet and mathematician, the intuitive and the supremely rational. This integration allows the detective to apprehend things hidden and obscured by intellectual practices that limit and constrain. The essential relationship between the philosophical, scientific, and aesthetic have been at the heart of McCarthy's writing life, and his striking out, together with the embrace of failure, perhaps most directly reflects McCarthy's productive debt to the late 19th century and to literary naturalism as a movement and genre. This literary naturalism involves the kind of writer preoccupied with philosophy, science, and literature together, the writer with an impulse to engage the world in all its intricacies and ambiguities, who renders things hidden in a way that broadens human perspective and touches the human soul. Philosophically considered, naturalism assumes a kind of pessimism with respect to human nature. A natural world governed by the Darwinian principle of natural selection is brutish and indifferent to human suffering. Human beings are determined by chemical forces that are often atavistic, monstrous, and cruel. But the artist renders these ideas with a degree of thoughtful indecision. The picture is darker and more exotic, emerging from both dream and nightmare. In this sense, literary naturalism takes the wilderness, the frontier, and scientific inquiry into a realm of the collective world imaginary. McCarthy is perhaps the most important contributor to a contemporary naturalist tradition. 1. Cormac McCarthy's work has elicited responses from critics that run the gamut in terms of worldview, from Gnosticism, Platonism, Neoplatonism, to the ideas of Kierkegaard and Nietzsche. Periods of literary history, such as Romanticism and Modernism, have all been explored in the polyvalent context of his canon. Like many of these movements, literary naturalism is a contested category. First employed to denote a broad grouping of European authors of the late 19th and early 20th centuries, the term applied to Americans describes a more focused group of fiction writers, specifically Stephen Crane, Frank Norris, Jack London, Theodore Dreiser, and Edith Wharton. Developing out of a transformation in culture that swept through the Western world in the latter half of the 19th century, naturalism involves a layered response to both aesthetic and intellectual concerns. In literary art, naturalism was initially seen as an extension of realism, which, under the influence of Europeans such as Émile Zola and Gustave Flaubert, and Americans such as Mark Twain and Henry James, asserted that literature should portray setting and character in rigidly mimetic terms. Stories in this vein bring to life all the grit, detail, and sordid reality that characterize human experience as it exists in the known world. The ideas and formal conventions of Romanticism persisted with vigor, but realists tried to distance themselves from romantic portrayals of ideal and mythic figures, who were often noble in birth and behavior, in favor of character types who came from various social classes and strata. Naturalism enthusiastically employed this blended romantic and realist aesthetic in the context of what was called the New Science, the revolutionary ideas of intellectuals such as Charles Darwin and Herbert Spencer. However, in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, reviewers and literary critics tended to oversimplify how these scientific precepts appeared in the fiction of naturalist writers, treating works such as Stephen Crane's Maggie, A Girl of the Streets, 1893, and The Red Badge of Courage, 1895, as well as Jack London's The Sea Wolf, 1904, and The Call of the Wild, 1903, as unambiguous representations of Darwinian precepts. Such accounts failed to consider how ideas are refracted and reimagined in the process of artistic creation. This perspective is expressed most notably in the third volume of Vernon Lewis Parrington's Main Currents in American Thought, 1930. Parrington concludes that American literary naturalism is a kind of pessimistic realism that places human beings in a mechanical world and understands them to be victims of an indifferent material universe. In 1963, George Becker codified this perspective, defining naturalism in American literature as no more than an emphatic and explicit position taken by some realists, showing man caught in a net from which there can be no escape, and degenerating under those circumstances. That is, it is pessimistic materialist determinism. But running parallel with Parrington and Becker, other critics recognized in the naturalism of the literary artist a more ambiguous rendering of the new science. In 1947, Malcolm Cowley acknowledged the pessimistic tendencies of the literary naturalists insofar as they limit the role of human agency in a deterministic universe. But Cowley argues that a rigid philosophical naturalism does not define naturalist fiction entirely. There is an undercurrent of optimism in the work of American literary naturalists that finds its source in the romance tradition. This optimism is observable not only in the patterns of genre, but in the themes of naturalist works. Especially later in the 1950s, a new generation of critics took this more nuanced perspective. Scholars such as Charles Child Walcott, Donald Pizer, and Lee Clark Mitchell carefully consider how artists encounter ideas and transform them through a complex process of creation and regeneration. Walcott challenges the notion of naturalism's debt to realism, suggesting that naturalism involves a divided stream, one branch reflecting Romanticism, and specifically New England transcendentalism. Lee Clark Mitchell pursues a new avenue by considering how naturalist determinism appears in linguistic structure and narrative itself. Donald Pizer explores the relationship between a purely naturalist vision and more traditional conceptions of our relationship to nature, writing that the naturalistic novel usually contains two tensions or contradictions. The two in conjunction comprise both an interpretation of experience and a particular aesthetic recreation of experience. He continues by arguing that despite naturalism's leveling of animals and humans, there is a compensating humanistic value that affirms the significance of the individual. A useful generalization can be drawn from these later inquiries. Writers are evolving human beings and artists, rather than philosophers or scientists bound by strict epistemological procedures. In terms of narrative, their works will re-envision in remarkable ways the concepts that interest them. The creative process and the fundamental exigencies of narrative make ideas new, distinctive, and rife with tensions and ambiguities. These critics recognized in naturalist fiction a more complex and polyvalent treatment of scientific precepts. And as this understanding of literary naturalism emerged, an enriched sense of its intellectual and aesthetic significance came to prominence. Literary naturalism was understood not just as the straightforward and monolithic, even dogmatic, presentation of materialism based in the biological sciences. Instead, the movement put these new ideas in play, in narratives that live initially in the consciousness of the artist, and emerge with all the strangeness and uncertainty that literary art by its nature permits. Literary naturalism encourages the reader to acknowledge the reality of the Darwinian concept of natural selection. The world is blind to human suffering, and human behavior is often bestial, atavistic, and monstrous. But despite this, literary naturalism explores things distinctly human, such as brotherhood, altruistic commitment to the other, and even spiritual awareness. Stephen Crane's The Open Boat, 1897, tells the story of four men at sea in a small skiff as they struggle to find their way to shore in a storm. The narrator acknowledges their environment as brutal, harsh, destructive, and finally, flatly indifferent. But the story emphasizes the subtle brotherhood among the men, a selflessness that cannot find easy explanation in purely materialistic terms. A rigid philosophical naturalism, then, finds itself in tension with a form of humanism that sets the species apart, makes it distinctive and rare. In considering the works of late 19th century writers such as Crane, Walcott and Pizer never deny the human capacity for avarice, greed, and violence. These realities, too, can be understood in human terms. But in their treatment of naturalism's leveling of the human and the animal, the human, in all its moral complexity, retains a palpable resonance. Continuing in this critical tradition, Eric Carl Link works to define the contours of literary naturalism in the late 19th and 20th centuries. In The Vast and Terrible Drama, American Literary Naturalism in the Late 19th Century, 2004, Link considers the movement from its inception forward. Reinforced by a reading of representative texts, Link posits a tripartite model for understanding how the new science came to fruition in various corners of our intellectual culture. He identifies three forms of naturalism: scientific naturalism, philosophical naturalism, and literary naturalism. Scientific naturalism refers to methodology. The scientific naturalist is the scientist, the individual who implements scientific methodology and depends on its epistemology to constitute objective truth in the physical world. In the same vein, the philosophical naturalist transforms that method into a worldview. For the philosophical naturalist, nothing exists beyond the tactile and material world, and no truth can be designated as such without reliance on the scientific method. In contrast to both, The literary naturalist is the writer who is attracted to Darwinian thinking, but is by no means confined by a purely empirical conception of the world. As an artist, rather than as a philosopher or scientist, the literary naturalist allows scientific and philosophical concepts to play freely in a narrative context centered on the human struggle. For this writer, ideas are compelling and provocative, even true, but questions of human and even the spiritual portent still deserve consideration in stories varied and polyvalent in their thematic implications. Given this modern and contemporary perspective, a host of 20th century writers might be considered through a naturalist lens: Ernest Hemingway, Sinclair Lewis, and William Faulkner, as well as later authors such as Larry McMurtry, Louise Erdrich, and Cormac McCarthy. Given his emphasis on the implacability of historical forces, William Faulkner might especially be considered in this vein, and his influence on McCarthy is undisputed. More broadly, the modernism that many of these authors helped define bears the indelible mark of the earlier naturalism, given that both movements engage ideas unique to the late 19th and early 20th centuries. They both rigorously explore philosophical determinism in all its social, biological, and historical manifestations. Beginning with The Orchard Keeper, 1965, and continuing through The Road, 2006, a firmly naturalistic vision works in dialectical interaction with a more humanistic and even romantic view of the human condition and the material universe. Outer Dark, 1968, concerns itself with the transformative role of transgression and guilt, but does so in the context of two characters' journey through a world both natural and man-made. It is a place haunted by the mysterious triune, who seem the mysterious outer projection of nature itself, as well as an emanation of a realm beyond human comprehension. Through the necrophiliac Lester Ballard, Child of God, 1974, echoes the novels of such naturalist writers as Frank Norris and Jack London in its presentation of the bestial and atavistic, while pointing with tortured sympathy to the character's humanity and fruitless struggle. Sutri, 1979, the last novel of McCarthy's Tennessee period, reflects the concerns of such naturalists as Stephen Crane, Theodore Dreiser, and Edith Wharton in exploring these themes in an urban setting, where in a modern context the struggle for survival is particularly acute. In the early 1980s, McCarthy moved to El Paso, Texas, to research the novel he initially termed his Western. That work was Blood Meridian, or The Evening Redness in the West, 1985. McCarthy remained in that region, which also became the setting for his Border trilogy. This series includes the National Book Award-winning All the Pretty Horses, 1992, The Crossing, 1994, and Cities of the Plain, 1998. The West proved to be a region entirely appropriate for a novelist exploring naturalist themes, and Blood Meridian certainly embodies the concerns of literary naturalism. At one point late in the novel, after readers have witnessed seemingly endless episodes of bloodletting, McCarthy describes a barren desert landscape in decidedly naturalist terms. In the neuter austerity of that terrain, all phenomena were bequeathed a strange equality, and no one thing, nor spider, nor stone, nor blade of grass, could put forth claim to precedence. The very clarity of these articles belied their familiarity, for the eye predicates the whole on some feature or part, and here was nothing more luminous than another, and nothing more enshadowed, and in the optical democracy of such landscapes, all preference is made whimsical, and a man and a rock become endowed with unguessed kinships. The leveling of the human and inhuman becomes a dominant focus of the novel, as does the distinct, though problematic, humanity of the protagonist, the unnamed kid. This same preoccupation appears in All the Pretty Horses, in which the main character, John Grady Cole, struggles to find a place in a natural world that is harsh and indifferent, yet mystically endowed. A blend of naturalist and transcendentalist conception, reminiscent of the divided stream explored by Walcott, appears in The Crossing, where, among other things, the image of the she-wolf connotes brutish, wild, and simultaneously spiritual realms. In Cities of the Plain, the pimp Eduardo speaks of the excessive adornment of Mexico as masking the plain reality of a brutal world. These literary naturalist concerns are prominent in later McCarthy works, such as The Road, 2006, The Sunset Limited, 2006, and The Counselor, 2013. In this sense, McCarthy's work involves themes and formal conventions similar to the naturalist ideas of 19th century writers, as well as to definitions of this tremendously influential aesthetic as explored by more modern critics. Of course, one of the most well-known early naturalists was Frank Norris, author of McTeague, 1899, The Octopus, 1901, The Pit, 1903, and Vandover and the Brute, 1894 to 1895, published 1914. Norris was one of the few writers of this period who attempted to explore in critical terms what it meant to be a literary naturalist. Acknowledging Zola as a founding figure in the movement, Norris wrote the 1896 essay Zola as Romantic Writer. In this brief treatise, Norris affirms the generic distinction later articulated at length by Richard Chase in The American Novel and Its Tradition, 1957. Chase and a generation of critics up to and including the present have observed that the genre can be divided into two formal strands. They are the narrative of social realism and the romance novel. The latter is divided into two categories: the mythic, as initially defined by James Fenimore Cooper and William Gilmore Sims, and the philosophical and psychological, as exemplified by Nathaniel Hawthorne and Herman Melville. For Norris, as Zola engages the new science and posits a world largely defined by atavism, violence, and brutal indifference to human suffering, he employs the conventions of the romance as well. His novels deal with scientific issues that in the 19th century could be placed within the context of what was termed natural philosophy, and was therefore a part of a philosophical tradition broadly construed. In A Plea for Romantic Fiction, 1901, Norris further affirms this formal distinction and argues that realism and naturalism are not departures from the romance. Instead, they are a logical and illuminating use of the genre, especially insofar as the romance allows for a deviation from a plot-level verisimilitude that permits the writer to directly engage philosophical questions. Throughout his work, McCarthy blends both the tangibly real and the otherworldly. We see this in The Crossing, as Billy Parham sets a trap for the she-wolf he will later commit to saving. Crouched in the broken shadow with the sun at his back, and holding the trap at eye level against the morning sky, he looked to be truing some older, more subtler instrument, astrolabe or sextant, like a man bent at fixing himself some way in the world, bent on trying by arc or cord the space between his being and the world that was, if there be such space. As Billy works at a workman's task, McCarthy presents him as the sailor at his instrument, navigating the world with ancient tools, objects designed to make the celestial vaguely tangible to human sensibilities. The world is a thing at once immutable and ever-changing. Whether aesthetic or scientific, the intellectual methods human beings have created make the mysterious at once comprehensible and sublime. Such is the nature of the romance and the implied purpose of the literary naturalist. 2. In August 1854, Putnam's monthly magazine published Herman Melville's The Lightning Rod Man. Often read as a critique of religious orthodoxy, the story is a direct and purposeful attack on orthodoxy of any kind. The tale is told from the point of view of a first-person narrator who is visited by a traveler in a storm. The traveling man is selling lightning rods and counting on his ability to articulate necessity and inspire fear. He tries to manipulate the narrator deceitfully. As the lightning rod man marshals expertise to create dread, he underestimates the narrator's savvy. The narrator is a firm skeptic, and in many ways a foil for Melville himself. At a figurative level, the lightning rod salesman is not only the door-to-door purveyor of religious tracts, but the scientific aficionado in the tradition of utopian 18th-century positivism. He is a modern man who has transformed science into application and seeks to peddle its supremacy. But the narrator responds with incredulity and anger as he sends the salesman on his way. "What has empowered you, you tetzel, to peddle around your indulgences from divine ordinations? The hairs of our heads are numbered, and the days of our lives. In thunder, as in sunshine, I stand at ease in the hands of my God. False negotiator, away! See, the scroll of the storm is rolled back, the house is unharmed, and in the blue heavens I read in the rainbow that the deity will not of purpose make war on man's earth." The thinly veiled allusion is to the religious charlatan who resells the Christian message at the front door of the susceptible believer. But the lightning rod is a tool that emerged from scientific understanding. The double allusion, then, is to the seller of science and technology as well. In this story, Melville explores the same tensions that motivate the work of the later naturalists, reflecting the Victorian dilemma, which involves religious doubt and the rise of highly productive scientific epistemologies. Melville runs crossways with the dominant and sometimes monolithic intellectual currents of his time. Religion does not offer a complete and adequate account of reality, not any longer. But the same is true of the new science, especially when it posits empirical process as the solution to all problems, social, moral, and intellectual. In 1889, Thomas Huxley coined the term agnosticism, linking the word to a model of thinking bound to empirical procedure. Melville anticipates Huxley, but extends that perspective into a radical skepticism, rejecting the efficacy of any totalizing system, religious, scientific, or philosophical. McCarthy's affiliation with the Santa Fe Institute acts as testimony to his respect for science. But the Santa Fe Institute has committed itself to breaking down epistemological boundaries. This iconoclastic approach to the acquisition of truth lies at the heart of McCarthy's engagement with the various scientific accounts he has encountered over the years. Early in Blood Meridian, he ponders the imponderable as the kid leaves home and travels west amid a violent and unforgiving world. Only now is the child finally divested of all that he has been. His origins are become remote, as is his destiny, and not again in all the world's turning will there be terrain so wild and barbarous to try whether the stuff of creation may be shaped to man's will, or whether his own heart is not another kind of clay. Amid a landscape both figurative and real, the kid stands in for the whole of humanity, his beginning beyond memory and his future impossible to chart on any map available to the intellect. The human spirit may transcend the world in mystery and the absolute, but it may with equal veracity be a sadly palliative illusion. This and other tensions are the central concern of American literary naturalists as they engage the intellectual culture of the late 19th century. In his long poem, War is Kind, 1899, Stephen Crane takes on the issue of war with seething irony and in the context of this critique, articulates perhaps the most direct expression of philosophical naturalism. A man said to the universe, "Sir, I exist." "However," replied the universe, "the fact has not created in me a sense of obligation." This verse is commonly anthologized separately from the larger poem, and as such presents an unvarnished and harshly naturalist perspective. There is nothing ambiguous about Crane's view of the human condition and the limited agency people possess in the context of an indifferent universe. Taking these five lines separately has a certain effect on the reader, and not an unreasonable one. The stanza serves as an expression of Crane's most important naturalist theme. Human beings are victims of forces beyond their control, and their significance appears meaningful only to themselves. But excising this section from the larger context of the poem limits the richness and polyvalence of Crane's concerns. When it is read as one stanza in a larger narrative, the naturalist themes are even more vivid and troubling. In War Is Kind, human beings are not merely victims, but the purveyors of mindless violence and war. This is the condition Judge Holden in Blood Meridian holds out to be the ordering principle of the universe. Here, the natural state is not one of indifference alone. Destruction is the most basic and operative reality in the world. But in writing a satirical and ironic critique of conventional heroism, Crane encourages reform and offers the possibility of altering the initial conditions of animal experience. Perhaps humans can create a community in which indifference and violence may be kept at bay, and more humane circumstances might prevail in which the sense of obligation is borne by all. Near the end of All the Pretty Horses, McCarthy ponders the kind of epiphany experienced by John Grady Cole. The young man has fought and killed to survive the brutal microcosm of a Mexican prison. In that other country, he has experienced both beauty and violence. But as he travels back to Texas, he sees a group of farm workers and perceives in them a humanity that transcends. They have goodwill that has power to protect and to confer honor and to strengthen resolve, power to heal men and to bring them to safety. Brotherhood and community are palpable and defining, even in a world of bloodletting and greed. It is this same sense of possibility and darkness that motivates the reformist ethos of Crane's Maggie, A Girl of the Streets, a novel that portrays the degraded and naturalistic conditions of the city, but implicitly argues for social change. In this sense, Crane's naturalism is polyvalent and complex, and in accepting the core reality of the natural world, Crane offers the human intellect and conscience as a partial remedy. Frank Norris explores these same issues in a set of novels that deal with the corruption and monopolistic practices of the progressive era. McTeague, A Story of San Francisco, 1899, portrays the sad experience of an unlicensed dentist and his wife, Trina. The story examines the degenerative influence of the city on an ill-fated man of lesser intelligence, who finds himself economically bereft after learning he can no longer practice without formal training. Trina wins the lottery but is excessively parsimonious, causing the oafish McTeague to descend into brutish and monstrous acts of abuse and murder. Naturalist themes of atavism and animality are nakedly rendered, but the novel locates the events in the vivid context of America's emerging urban space, a territory that seems to cultivate, rather than mitigate, the worst human impulses. McCarthy portrays this same reality in Sutri, an urban novel that explores the degradation of the modern city and its influence on a set of characters who struggle to cope in a place that seems blind to their needs and hopes. Both novels assert and challenge the boundaries of a rigid philosophical naturalism, since the violence latent both in the world and in the human heart seems to transcend the imperative to survive. McTeague's ultimate brutality seems motivated by an impulse beyond reason, and suggests something monstrous in nature that resists explanation. The Octopus, A Story of California, 1901, the first volume in Norris's unfinished Epic of the Wheat trilogy, provides a fictionalized account of the Mussel Slough tragedy in California's San Joaquin Valley, the culmination of a conflict between wheat farmers and San Francisco's Central Pacific Railroad. The novel foregrounds nature's most operative principle in action, the struggle that circumscribes not just the individual, but the collective. Through the main character, the aspiring writer Presley, the narrative displays sympathy for the farmers, and it counterpoints the naturalist plot of decline with the sad but perhaps just fate of the antagonist. In the end, the novel suggests Walcott's divided stream, as it blends nature's indifference with the pantheistic vision of the American transcendentalists and the ameliorative evolutionary theory of Joseph LeConte. Vandover and the Brute, 1894 to 1895, published 1914, and The Pit, 1903, involve these same tensions. With a naturalistic worldview as background, these novels encourage activism and help initiate the reformist tradition most notable in the later novels of Sinclair Lewis. Perhaps the most popular and well-known writer associated with late 19th and early 20th century naturalism is Jack London, and novels such as The Call of the Wild, 1903, and White Fang, 1906, have entered the public consciousness not only as rousing stories, but as inquiries into the brute nature of the world outside the confines of human civilization. Certainly, London, from his own experience, brings to light the indifference of nature in the Yukon and the tenacious instinct for survival manifest in the two animals seem strangely personified in the narratives. But the brutish nature of men both exemplifies and challenges the boundaries of a rigid philosophical naturalism. Unlike the dense and ill-adapted protagonist in London's To Build a Fire, 1902, men in The Call of the Wild and White Fang are often...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.